We now move on to questions to the Minister for the Economy. I call Mr. Stuart Dixon. Mr. Dixon.
Question number one.
Minister.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, with your permission, I will group the answers to questions one and four. The Renewable Heat Incentive Scheme Amendment Regulations Northern Ireland 2017 were approved by the Assembly yesterday. When I brought the regulations before the Assembly, I stated that they were the first step towards reducing the burden on the Northern Ireland budget. I also outlined additional action I was taking on inspection, audit and enforcement. My officials are progressing work to tender for 100% site inspections. The site inspection process, coupled with vigorous investigation and enforcement action, will bear down on future costs. The changes in the scheme, Mr. Deputy Speaker, will have effect for only 1 year, and we can and will make any necessary reasonable corrections when a long-term solution is developed for implementation from the 1st of April next year. In putting forward a long-term solution, we will consult and listen to the views of insulation owners and other stakeholders.
I call Mr. Dixon, supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Minister, yesterday one of the assurances that you gave to the House was in respect of the robustness of your scheme, and yet this afternoon we learned that some 300 boiler owners have managed to block and thwart your promise to this House and to the citizens of Northern Ireland to deliver the names of boiler owners. In those circumstances, Minister, will you publish the names of those others who are not currently blocked by this injunction?
Minister.
Of course, the member, thank the member for his question. However, he is conflating two issues. I, like him, in fact, I wrote to his party leader and indeed all Assembly party leaders and before making the announcement that I did last week in terms of wanting to publish the names of all non-domestic, or sorry, the details of the businesses in receipt of the non-domestic RHI scheme yesterday, or tomorrow, sorry, was my intention to do that. Unfortunately, as the member says, an injunction has been placed on those who are members of the Renewable Heat Association. I've only just received the news. I haven't seen the full judgment yet, and as the member in the House, Mr. Speaker, Deputy Speaker, would expect, I will wish to consider that in full before making any decision in regard to it. But I'm sure that he, like me, indeed his party leader, wrote to me wishing to have the fullest of transparency around the names. That would still be my objective, and that was what I was seeking to do by making the announcement that I did last week. We had to run through a process which the department undertook in a pretty quick time, given the volume of work that was there, and I signalled my intention to publish the names, and consistent with the process as laid out in Section 10 of the Data Protection Act. I deeply regret the injunction that has been sought and awarded this afternoon, because I do think it certainly, in and of itself, it prevents full transparency. And obviously, I will take the time to consider what can now be done in the circumstances.
Thank you. I call Justin McNulty.
Minister, there are other ways of making public information which allows us to identify details in relation to usage around the RHI scheme. Is the Minister willing to make public that sort of information in terms of geographic locations of where the scheme has been most abused?
Particularly given, as I said in response to Mr. Dixon, Deputy Speaker, I mean, obviously given the judgment today, we'll have to reflect on how we can give the fullest possible transparency. That's what I want to achieve, and I think from listening to the member, that's what he wishes to see as well. And obviously there are a range of different ways, and he says there are other ways in which information could be done there, and I agree with him, there are a range of different ways in which it could be presented. It wouldn't necessarily be the fullest transparency that I think that not only the members in the House wish to see, but also those outside in the general, just to instill public confidence in, which is unfortunately lacking at this minute in time. So I wanted to see it happen. We went down the road of a process to allow that to happen, signal our intention to do that. Unfortunately, the injunction has been sought and awarded today. I will look at a range of different ways, a range of the options that I will have to continue to pursue that goal of transparency in the light of the judgment that has been made this afternoon.
Thank you. I call Alan Chambers.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Mr. Minister, yesterday the Permanent Secretary, in addressing the Economy Committee, told the committee that the mitigation plan that formed the part of the statutory rule that was passed through the House yesterday had actually been started, the formation of it had started on the 30th of December. He indicated to us that it was a SPAD from another department who had actually come forward with the idea but he refused to name that spa. I wonder, Minister, could you share that information with the House today?
Mr. Deputy Speaker, the member asked the question almost as if it's a bad thing that a special adviser from any department has a good idea. If the member had come forward to me with a good idea, I may have listened to it and taken it forward, but of course he didn't. So look, you know, I think the origins of the idea, and of course it was an idea that was developed over time and been put forward and to the House, and the regulations that were submitted to the House last week and passed last night. I think what we should be focusing on is not the origins or the genesis of the idea, but the fact that it is a robust, legally robust idea, which is now passed through regulations, which will allow the significant reduction of the costs to and the budgetary shortfall on the RHI scheme, reduces it from an estimated £30 million next year down to between £2 and £2.5 million, and that is before we bear down on those costs further, Mr. Deputy Speaker, through audit and inspection and enforcement.
I call Gordon Lyons.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answer so far and for his commitment that his department will carry out 100% site inspections. Would the Minister be able to inform the House when that process of site inspections will begin?
Mr. Deputy Speaker, it is something that signalled a few weeks ago that this was the intention to do this. And of course, the member will know and the House will know that inspections of all installations would have taken place over the lifetime of the scheme. But obviously, it's a fairly long lifetime that the scheme has, and all installations would have been inspected during the lifetime of the RHI, which is 20 years. Clearly, in the circumstances that we find ourselves in, and particularly with accusations or of fraud and abuse, I don't think that we can leave it for that length of time to inspect. So we need to accelerate that. That will take some resource to do that, Deputy Speaker. But a tender is in the process of being drafted, which will go out because of the scale of it, has to go out Europe-wide. But I still anticipate, even though there is a legal process to go through in that regard, I still expect the 100% the tender to be awarded in the coming months, and for that to start in the not too distant future. I think it's incredibly important that we do that. Again, it's part of instilling public confidence, which is lacking. Plus, also, it is critically important, as I've said previously, critically important to further bearing down on the cost of the RHI to the Northern Ireland budget, with £2 to £2.5 million estimated of a shortfall next year. A combination of more behavioural change, plus, I believe, the bearing down of costs through inspections and audits, and importantly, Mr. Deputy Speaker, enforcement. I think we can reduce that further and closer to zero.
Thank you. I call Jim Allister.
An interim injunction is generally granted on an ex parte application, that's to say without the respondent being present or heard. Was that the situation today, or was the department heard? And if it was an interim injunction on that basis, it only lasts, of course, until there is a full hearing. When is that full hearing on this matter?
I don't know the answer to his final question of his two questions that he asked, but I'll revert to the member with that. But the department was there. The department was represented. Representations were made to the court on behalf of the department.
We move on. I call Pam Cameron.
Question number two.
Minister.
Deputy Speaker, it is important that we continue to build RR connectivity so that it is easy as possible for people all over the world to access Northern Ireland for both business and tourism purposes. I'm therefore encouraged by the latest air passenger statistics, which show that there were 7.89 million air passengers passing through Northern Ireland's airports in the year to September 2016. This represents a 9.2% increase in passengers on the previous year, and passenger numbers are at their highest since the pre-recession peak of 8.27 million in 2008. The statistics give a clear indication that growth is returning to the Northern Ireland air travel market. We've also had a number of positive announcements of new air routes in recent times, including a new Iceland air service to Reykjavik from Belfast City Airport from June this year, as well as the establishment of a Ryanair hub at Belfast International Airport. However, it was deeply regrettable that we saw earlier this month the departure from Belfast International Airport of United Airlines' last direct flight to Newark. Along with the International Airport, the Executive had agreed a package of financial support last summer that was aimed at maintaining this important business and tourism route. I continue to work closely with the International Airport to explore other possible air routes to North America, and I remain hopeful that there will be some positive developments in this regard in the coming months. In September last year, the Executive announced a £7 million package for the North West to assist development and growth around the City of Derry Airport, which includes up to £2.5 million route development support to assist the airport to launch new routes. Now, officials are in discussion with representatives from both the City of Derry Airport and Derry City and Strabane District Council on the mechanism to provide route development support. I've also announced my intention to establish a new air routes task force that will help to identify key routes that Northern Ireland's airports should be targeting, as well as identifying possible policy interventions and initiatives to attract new airlines.
Thank you, Pam Cameron, for supplementary.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answer. Could I ask the Minister if he could update this Assembly on what efforts are being made to attract new airlines to start air routes from between Belfast International and North America?
Minister.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, as I said earlier, it's deeply disappointing that United made its last flight from Belfast International earlier this month, and I've been on record in this House and elsewhere in stating my belief in the importance of having more direct routes to North America, both for business and for tourism reasons. So it was deeply regrettable that the United package didn't work out and United withdrew their flight. I have, though, and I'm sure the International Airport could testify to this as well. Interestingly, what came out of what was a negative story was something positive in terms of the interest, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that many airlines showed in coming to Northern Ireland, catalysed in part by the fact that they saw a government here at Stormont who were prepared to roll their sleeves up and get involved and offer support where it was appropriate to do so. That has led to a number of leads and some significant interest from a number of airlines. In fact, in the last few weeks, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I have been able to sign off and agree a recommendation from officials to offer some support to an airline that proposes to offer two direct flights from Belfast International to destinations in the United States of America. And that is working its way through that airline and its processes and approval processes. And I would hope that we would be able to see some positive news in respect of that in the not-too-distant future. And I continue, and I will continue, for as long as I am in post, to work with the airlines, and particularly with the International Airport and indeed the other airports in Northern Ireland, to try to improve not just our routes to North America, but our connectivity on a much broader front as well.
Thank you. I call David Ford.
Thank you, Speaker. Given the way in which Belfast International Airport is in direct competition with Dublin for overseas routes, could the Minister indicate whether he's had any conversations with his colleague, the Minister for Infrastructure, around developing both public transport links and better roads in the Aldergrove area?
Minister.
I haven't had any direct discussions with the Minister for Infrastructure about this, although I would support the improvement of infrastructure to the airport. I think accessibility is key to improving connectivity, and I know that there are long-standing issues. I think colleagues, so Mr. Gervin was in the House earlier, and colleagues from Southampton brought forward a motion not too long ago in this House calling for the reopening of the railway line and some connectivity into the terminal at Belfast International. And I know that there are proposals to improve road access in that area too. So I do think that that's critically important to improving connectivity. It's certainly something that particularly business passengers, but also tourists, look for to have good connectivity between the airport and where they're ultimately going to. I think that the International Airport has performed, as indeed has the City Airport in Belfast, performed incredibly well in difficult circumstances. And the member mentions the competition that they receive or that they have from Dublin Airport. It's a very unfair competition, in my view. I think the playing field is very much slanted towards Dublin. And I think we have got to accept that Dublin is a very different proposition. It's a very different city, a very different airport of a very different scale. But it does have huge support because of the nature of its ownership through its government. There's a lot of public support, which I do think ultimately leads to a fairly uneven and unfair position in terms of competition between the Belfast and all of the Northern Ireland airports and Dublin. That was something that I would have hoped to be able to work towards rectifying, accepting the realities of the situation. And we were, I think, on the way to doing that. Unfortunately, now I think the efforts that I will be able to make in post will be limited given the circumstances that we find ourselves in.
I call Steve Aiken.
Deputy Minister, for your comments so far. Just looking at, you'll be aware of the comments today by Ryanair about the cost of the new runway at Dublin Airport. And bearing in mind that this has been funded through the state, would the Minister care to refer Dublin Airport Authority to the EU Competition Authority, particularly for its seemingly use of state funds for building infrastructure in an unfair manner?
Minister.
Well, that's an interesting idea that the member has. I suppose he's due a good idea. I'll
reflect on the comments that he's made and see what it may be
the last act that I make in office, perhaps, Mr. Deputy Speaker, if it was to take the member up on his recommendation. But look, I think he is in his own particular style making the point that I was making, I think, in response to Mr. Ford, which is that I do think there are many different ways in which that competition really isn't a competition. And I think, as I said before, I think we've got to accept that Northern Ireland's airports cannot compete directly, and a lot of those routes are probably that Dublin are able to secure are probably not going to come to any Northern Ireland airports. But it is where there are those routes which they could be coming here, and there are many routes where there is a significant volume of the passengers coming from Northern Ireland, but yet they're going on flights out of the Dublin airport, and there are lots of different reasons for that. Which we've discussed many times in this House. But I do think the member makes a very good point around the fact that the playing field is not always an even one between our airports here in Northern Ireland and those in Dublin.
Thank you. We move on. I call Mr. Sidney Anderson.
Question number three.
Minister. Mr. Deputy Speaker, Northern Ireland's centenary in 2021 will be a momentous occasion. Marking the first 100 years of Northern Ireland will be a landmark event and something we will be proud to celebrate. In recent years, we've demonstrated our prowess in showcasing Northern Ireland on the world stage with events such as the Giro d'Italia, MTV Music Awards, the World Police and Fire Games, and the G8 Summit. We have become known around the world for our great ambassadors, whether they be sporting personalities such as Rory McIlroy, Graham McDowell, and Darren Clark, musicians like Van Morrison and Phil Coulter, or our football team and its fans, which did so much to promote Northern Ireland's reputation during the 2016 European Championships. The 2016 Year of Food and Drink was also a great success, highlighting how far our restaurants and indeed our chefs have come over recent years. As we move closer to Northern Ireland's centenary, we do so against a backdrop of increasing tourism industry growth. This growth has seen record visitor levels to Northern Ireland over the last number of years. The most recent statistics indicate further growth in Northern Ireland's tourism industry. As well as local significance, the centenary will have an international significance as well for the many people living overseas who retain a strong connection with Northern Ireland. The centenary will provide a further opportunity to reflect on Northern Ireland's success. My department will play a key role in celebrating the centenary, and Tourism NI and Tourism Ireland will have their part to play in ensuring that this event is promoted to the fullest extent.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for that response. Minister, Northern Ireland has a great industrial history. Can I ask you how you believe that the success of Northern Ireland's industry can be promoted as part of the centenary celebrations?
Mr. Speaker, I'm not sure this is the member's last contribution in the chamber, but it's certainly one of his last contributions. Of course, he announced last week that he would not be standing for election on the 2nd of March. Can I beg your indulgence, Deputy Speaker, to put on record my appreciation for the service that Sydney has put in down through the years. I've known Sydney for a long time. I think my father actually worked with Sydney at a time. Well, I think they were employed in the same place. And I've known Sydney for a long time, way back to the days when both of us were agitating in the Ulster Unionist Party before we saw the light. But respect.
I can well remember those days too.
I think the member is absolutely right that any celebration of Northern Ireland's 100th birthday should be one that reflects on the great strengths, what makes Northern Ireland a great place to live and to work and to visit and to invest in. And of course that is partly our industrial history as well. And we do have, sometimes we forget this, a wonderful, rich, vibrant industrial heritage in this part of the world. There are, you know, I think we are all immensely, and we should, if we're not, we should be immensely proud
of the, particularly the engineering prowess of people from this part of the world, and the entrepreneurial spirit, which is very much evident in the members' Upper Band constituency. But I do think we have to look to the future as well, and I want to see us not only reflect on our past glories, but also what is the potential of the Northern Ireland economy and Northern Ireland industry moving forward. And one of the things that I will be instructing officials to take forward as part of our celebrations of the 2021 is borrowing on a theme that was in there in 1971 for their 50th anniversary. The member might remember that, those celebrations, was an expo in Belfast. I think there's a great opportunity to do something like that to celebrate not just our rich industrial heritage, but also look to the potential of business and the economy and industry here in Northern Ireland.
Thank you. I call Harold McKay.
Speaker, will the Minister agree that the tourism potential of Northern Ireland's centenary in 2021 will be easier to realise if we have a proper cross-community government which will work for the common good of all the people of Northern Ireland? Does he realise that this is not possible under DUP Sinn Féin Executive Office?
Minister.
Congratulations. Well done to the member on reading out his election material for the next month. I think that, I'll not descend to the members' level in this regard, but I'll take the point around having a government. I do believe that it is critically important if we are to, never mind anything about 2021 and Northern Ireland's centenary, as important as that is. If Northern Ireland is to move forward, it needs a strong and stable government here at Stormont. And I hope that we find ourselves in difficult circumstances, Deputy Speaker. But I know in my job, perhaps better than most ministers in the executive, the importance of having a government here and an administration here at Stormont in terms of attracting investment and, as the member highlights, attracting tourists to come here as well, who also want to see stability. So I hope that we can get through our present difficulties and form a government too far side of the next of the election on the 2nd of March, and continue to build on the progress. And there has been substantial progress has been made over the last 10 years, whether the member and his party like it or not. Substantial, huge progress has been made. Northern Ireland is an infinitely better place today than it was 10, 20, 30 years ago. We need to continue to build on that progress and keep Northern Ireland moving in the right direction.
We move on. I call Mr. George Robinson.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, misleading advertising of broadband speeds by internet service providers has been an area of concern for me. It is less than acceptable that residential and business customers cannot get accurate information on the broadband speed they will receive when entering into contracts with service providers. I wrote to the Advertising Standards Authority in August 2016 to offer my full support to the call by the Local Government Association for changes to the advertising rules for broadband suppliers. This is particularly relevant to Northern Ireland is a largely rural community. I therefore welcome the news that the Advertising Standards Authority has taken the decision to reform or change the rules on advertising broadband speeds in order to offer better clarity.
Mr. Robinson, supplementary.
Thank the Minister for his answer. What does the Minister's department plan to do to improve broadband speeds across Northern Ireland, and in particular rural areas such as those in my East Londonderry constituency?
Thank the member for his question, and I know that this is an issue that exercises the member, and indeed his constituency has written to me and contacted me on several occasions about poor broadband speeds in part of his East Londonderry constituency. And I accept that, as I have many times in relation to different parts of Northern Ireland, and do so later on this evening, that the speeds that some businesses and residential customers get are not acceptable and are slower and not as reliable as they ought to be. The executive has put considerable investment into broadband speeds over the last number of years. Some £60 million has been put in the last number of years, which has then helped to unlock private sector investment from BT and from others. Now, we have had success before in being the first region in Europe to have 100% broadband capability. I think we need to get back to those days where we have amongst the best broadband infrastructure in Europe. It is a commitment which is contained within the draft industrial strategy which has been published today to get back to those days when we did have an enviable broadband infrastructure here in Northern Ireland. My department has been working on a comprehensive and ambitious plan as well to look at rolling out fibre to the premises right across Northern Ireland, whether people are in an urban setting or in part of the rural areas of Northern Ireland. It was an ambitious plan, which one that I hope to bring forward through the budget process and get a commitment for. Unfortunately now, Mr. Deputy Speaker, as we know, that is hampered by the circumstances that we find ourselves in. And unfortunately, that is not something that I believe we'll be able to take forward in the next little while, but it is an idea which is still developing and growing within the department, and I hope that we will be able to take it forward the other side of the election.
Thank you. I call Kelly Armstrong.
Thank you very much, Deputy Speaker. Can I thank the Minister for his answer so far, and I really do mean that as a fellow Strangford MLA for the Strangford constituency. He will understand that our concerns regarding broadband are that although the supplier may well say that there's very good coverage, that actually the speeds are quite pathetic in some areas. And I'm just wondering, within the department, what measures have been taken, what measurements have been taken so far to measure out where those difficulties are, to ensure that we have access to schools where their STEM has been limited. Now, businesses, rural business in particular, that are finding that the speeds are making it difficult.
I think we have the question.
Thank you.
Thank the member for her question. We don't have figures by constituency basis, but if you take North Down and Ards area, which would include most of the member and I's constituency, speeds at a global level, the speeds are actually not that bad. So 98% of premises are able to get 2 megabytes or more, 96.5 megabytes per second or more, 93 at 10 megabits per second, and 83 at 30 megabits per second. That's one of the best in Northern Ireland. But clearly there are still people who are getting intermittent, not strong signals, not strong speeds, and just speeds are simply not acceptable. There have been a range of different, and something that I think I perhaps emphasised to the member and indeed to the House before, that whilst I accept that those aren't good enough, and that's why we've been developing the plan that we have, there are alternative technologies in place which can present the opportunity for those who just cannot get acceptable speeds, and there is support there from my department to do that. And I've said to members before that they should contact the department about that, rather than sometimes getting fibre, which is sort of the gold standard, Deputy Speaker, is not possible in all locations. I think sometimes some people just say, well, if I can't get that, then I can't get anything at all. That is not always the case. There are satellite and there are wireless technologies which can provide a decent speed, not necessarily the speed that people want to get, but at least a decent speed. So the member had asked about analysis. There is some analysis that's been done. I'll write to her with the precise numbers, but I think it's in a range of about 30,000 premises across Northern Ireland, with the majority of those being in rural areas, premises who cannot get speeds of 2 megabytes per second or more. And that's not acceptable. I want to bear down on that. I want to see that improve, and that's why we were developing the plan that we were. And I hope, as I said to Mr. Robinson, I hope that in spite of the current political difficulties, we will still be able to take that plan forward in the not-too-distant future.
Thank you. We move on. I call Mr. Robin Swan.
Number 6.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, members will be aware that a new economic strategy was being developed to align with the Executive's draft programme for government. The strategy, which sets out an ambitious long-term vision to transform Northern Ireland into a globally competitive economy that works for everyone, was nearing the point at which it could be released for public consultation. We are now facing a critically important period for the Northern Ireland economy. Now more than ever, there needs to be a strong strategic framework for growth in place. And I therefore can confirm to the House that I have released, through my department today, the draft industrial strategy for public consultation. The consultation will run for 12 weeks, and I would encourage all interested parties to engage in this consultation process.
Mr. Swan, supplementary.
I thank the Minister for releasing that strategy today. Will it take into consideration the strong recommendations made by the Ulster Unionist Party for a manufacturing strategy, especially in regard to the high job losses that were lost in my constituency in North Antrim?
I'm well aware of the issues that have affected the member's constituency in respect to manufacturing job losses, and you know, it has had a devastating impact on the local community, and that is still actually working its way through the local economy. The member will see if he hasn't taken a look at it. It's good bedtime reading for him. To take a copy, download a copy and read it overnight, he will see that there is a significant emphasis within the industrial strategy on the manufacturing sector in Northern Ireland. Our manufacturing sector is, in spite of, and I don't dismiss, and I wouldn't dismiss for a second, the impact that it has on individuals, on their families, on local communities, the sort of job losses that we've seen in the Ballymena area have. But the manufacturing sector has still, nonetheless, been strong and performing strongly across the board in Northern Ireland. In 2015, there were around 80,000 jobs within the sector, and that's the best since 2008. Sales were up 1.7% in 2014. In 2015, exports by the sector were up by £350 million, and output has also been performing strongly as well. And I'm immensely proud of, in spite of difficulties globally and locally, I'm immensely proud of the success of manufacturers across Northern Ireland, including Wrightbus in his own North Antrim constituency, who have that honour of being able to say that they construct one in three of all London's famous red buses. And it is that sort of prowess in manufacturing that you will see emphasised, underlined, highlighted, and also importantly supported in the new draft industrial strategy, which has been published today.
Thank you. That completes listed questions. We now move on to topical questions, and I call Mr. Alex Atwood.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. The Minister just referred to publication of the industrial strategy, and earlier referred to the record visitor numbers. Could you update the Assembly about where the tourism strategy is?
Yeah. The tourism strategy is something that has been in my department, been working through the department. It is something, obviously, and similarly to the industrial strategy, which has been ready for publication, or has been nearing the completion, nearing that point where it could be published for some time. Obviously, the circumstances that we find ourselves in make it slightly difficult to, sort of impossible to get executive agreement, so it would not be an executive strategy. It is something that I intend to discuss with officials as to what might be possible. In fact, communication has been made to Tourism and I in recent times to see if we can bring that forward with our officials in the department, because I do think it's important, and no matter what is happening politically, that we are still giving a clear signal and direction of travel for not just the economy through an industrial strategy, but also to continue to improve on our tourism performance, which has been doing incredibly well in recent times.
Mr. Atwood, supplementary.
Thank you, Minister, for that answer. But is it not more accurate that the last executive failed to agree a tourism strategy? This executive has failed a tourism strategy. We've come out of the year of food and drink. We are 4 months from the Irish Open at Port Stewart. We're 2 years from the British Open at Port Rush. Is this not evidence of failure? And given the 2021 the 2021 anniversary, 100 years since the creation of Northern Ireland, do you recognise that that year should also acknowledge that there are many people who regret the partition of Ireland, as well as many people who celebrate the creation of Northern Ireland?
Number of questions for the Minister.
Quite a few. I regret that because of circumstances, the tourism strategy will not be able to be agreed by the executive. Sinn Féin walking away from the executive has also obviously made that impossible. They've also obviously walked away from proceedings today. I'm disappointed that my question time was not even enough to draw them back into the chamber this afternoon. It's deeply disappointing. I don't consider it I will look at how we can bring forward the tourism strategy in the circumstances that we can find it, we find ourselves in. But let us not fall into the position and our belief that the absence of a tourism strategy will inhibit. It clearly would help in terms of setting clear targets and focusing ourselves on key goals. But tourism in Northern Ireland has been a success story. Figures recently published by NISRA, which are the year ending September of 2016, show that visitor spend in Northern Ireland is now at £821 million. 74% of that is coming from external visitors, so just over £600 million from external visitors. That's a 10% increase in overall spend year on year. We now have 4.6 million visitors coming to Northern Ireland annually. External visitors. Importantly, external visitors are up 8% to 2.5 million, the highest ever on record. And as I mentioned before, 10% increase in bed spaces sold. And as I mentioned in response to Mrs. Cameron's question earlier, we've seen that reflected in air passenger flows go up at Belfast International and at Belfast City Airport. So, I don't consider tourism in Northern Ireland to be a failure. I regret that the executive has not been able to agree because of the circumstances that we're in a tourism strategy. But tourism continues to go from strength to strength, and I believe that with some of the events that the member has mentioned, it will continue to do so.
Thank you. I call Sandra Overend.
Deputy Speaker, can I ask the Minister to comment on the ruling of the Supreme Court on Brexit?
I obviously have been following other court proceedings today, as the member might be aware, so I haven't had a chance to fully look at and study the judgment that has been made by the Supreme Court.
Minister. Sandra Ober, supplementary.
Thank the Deputy Speaker for that. And bearing in mind the Supreme Court decision, well, given the lack of any agreed Brexit position from the outgoing Northern Ireland executive, does the Minister have any idea how the position of the Northern Ireland economy will be put on the agenda in London?
Yeah, I think the member makes a valid point in respect of here is an issue in terms of Brexit and Northern Ireland's position and seeking to get the best deal for Northern Ireland, which is clearly hampered by the situation that we are now in, with Sinn Féin walking away, Deputy Speaker, from the executive. It makes it at a time of criticality in respect of the triggering of Article 50, however that will be done by, and when that will be done by the Prime Minister. It is incredibly important that Northern Ireland's voice is still heard, and unfortunately, given the circumstances we are in, that is going to become incredibly difficult as a result of what Sinn Féin have done in pulling out of the executive. But the Northern Ireland executive has, over the last number of months, since the referendum result back in June, has been bombarding Whitehall with information about the Northern Ireland economy. We have been engaging at ministerial level, or at Secretary of State level, in various different departments, and crucially with David Davis and his department, the department responsible for Brexit. And it is clear from that engagement that that message and the need for the particular circumstances that Northern Ireland faces, the particular circumstances created by our history and geography, that message is getting through, and you're hearing that verbalised by very clear support for Northern Ireland's position coming from the Prime Minister. I was able to engage with the Prime Minister of Malta before Christmas. He is now the President of the European Council, and it was, I think, significant that he acknowledged the particular circumstances that Northern Ireland faces, pointed out that it was one of, in respect of Brussels' position, one of the key priorities for the European for Brussels to deal with the situation here in Northern Ireland. And I think that bodes well for a positive outcome for Northern Ireland from the upcoming negotiations.
I call Claire Hannah.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank the Minister. Can the Minister outline what contingency or plan B the Department had in place in the event that has now come to pass that there was a ruling on publishing the RHI names that still allows for transparency on this issue?
As I was saying to others, including a colleague of hers, earlier on in proceedings, that obviously the ruling has just been made in the last hour. I haven't seen it yet. I will wish to, as a member would expect me to study it carefully before deciding what we will do. But I do reiterate the point once again that I want to have the fullest possible transparency around the details of recipients of the non-domestic RHI scheme, and it is with that in mind that I will look at the ruling and come forward with a decision as quickly as possible.
Hannah, supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. My question was about a contingency or a plan B, because obviously the challenge was entirely foreseeable, and I wonder, has the Minister given any thought to publishing even an anonymised list of that could contain some geographical detail, the date and the output and payment, so that we can get a sense of the level of payments or the level of applicants that are credible and the level of applicants that are not credible?
I thank the member for her question. I think it's asked in the appropriate spirit. Clearly, the whole purpose of doing this was to seek to instill better public confidence. And the member says it was foreseeable, it was going to be challenged. Yes, I suppose it was. I think what I've heard about the judgment is that it is not permissible to publish the names of members of the Renewable Heat Association. That was a slightly left field judgment as far as I was concerned. But however, I am happy to look, and I will look at other options. I think it's interesting that the member says that there is something short of the full disclosure, which the court is now preventing from happening, which may help to instill public confidence. And that's what I want to do. That's what my objective is. And I will certainly look at the option that the member has said, along with indeed others, to hope to achieve that purpose of maximum transparency and with the aim of instilling public confidence in the scheme.
I call Chris Little.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. The Minister, in relation to the publication of RHI recipients, says that he obviously has limitations and challenges to overcome, but is it his own ultimate ambition to publish the names and addresses of all participants when they applied, and if so, when does he expect to be able to do so?
I'm not sure, you know, if the member has appreciated or picked up the point, and I appreciate that he too will not have perhaps seen the full judgment and will want to take a look at it as well. It is my objective. I mean, that is what was my publicly stated position. It was a position that I stated in writing to recipients of the scheme that I wished to, because I believed that there was a public interest, a clear public interest in having maximum transparency, that it was my intention to publish business details and geographical information as well as other information as well. I would still hope to be able to do that, but obviously I will have to reflect on the judgment that has been made.
Mr. Little, supplementary.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Thank the Minister for his answer. There has been some reference to the application form for the RHI scheme making limitations in terms of the information that can be made available. Can he elaborate on what his assessment is of the limitations of the application form for the House?
Sir Deputy Speaker, as you would expect, we've been seeking to publish details of the recipients of the non-domestic RHI scheme consistent with a range of legal obligations. And at all stages I've sought, received and sought to abide by the legal advice that I received. And some of that legal advice was, whilst I've heard many say that the privacy policy allowed for this, the publication of the details, business details, and some limited information, some of the legal advice that I received, Deputy Speaker, significantly said that anything that even the business name, which could relate back to who the individuals associated were, and obviously nobody gave them permission for their individual names to be published, could contravene the Data Protection Act, and that's why the process, which was done in fairly short order, why the process had to be undertaken to put all of those objections that were received against a public interest test. But I would want to emphasise again to the member and indeed to the House that I would still hope to be able to be in a position to publish details at some date in the future. I will look at suggestions that that other members have made in terms of somewhat limited data, but always on the basis of trying to have maximum transparency and instill public confidence.
Thank you. Mind the Minister of a 2-minute rule. I call Nicola Mallam.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. May I ask the Minister, given the hard Brexit stance taken by the Conservative Prime Minister, does he now accept that the case must be made for special status for Northern Ireland, and does he accept that his party to date has got it wrong and needs to urgently reassess its position in respect of that matter?
Minister.
You know, I think the member, unfortunately, you know, has once again proven how our party has not accepted the result of the verdict of the British people. Now, you know, I think that the Prime Minister has, and I think I welcome the clarity that she has brought to this position and to her negotiating position. I think there was some doubt for some time as to what she was going to do or what she was going to seek, and it is now very, very clear what her objectives are. Look, and I have said, as I repeat what I said in response to Mrs. Overend, you know, I think that Northern Ireland will and should continue to seek, hampered as it is by the circumstances in which we find ourselves in, a deal which reflects the particular circumstances of Northern Ireland. Northern Ireland and where it is located has a particular history and a particular geography which must be reflected, I believe, in any ultimate deal. And you know, it is regrettable that for a while at least the Northern Ireland voice will not be heard as clearly as it should be at a critical time within those negotiations, and it is unfortunate that is the case. But you know, I think that, as I said before, Northern Ireland's voice has been heard loudly and clearly, and Northern Ireland's interests have been heard loudly and clearly over the last number of months, and I think that it is well understood by the Prime Minister and her team what those particular circumstances, what the history, unique history and geography of this part of the world are, and I would hope that that would be reflected in an ultimate deal, which I think is, and I also think that that has been viewed very sympathetically in Brussels as well.
Nicola Mallon for supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Given that the former First Minister, given the current political context, Arlene Foster, has previously outlined the need for the free movement of labour. How is this compatible with the position articulated then by the Prime Minister, Theresa May?
The Prime Minister has outlined her objectives in respect of negotiations, and I think the former First Minister and the others within the House have emphasised the need to, particularly to have the common travel area remain in place. And it's welcome that the Prime Minister, one of the 10 points that she pointed out last week, was to maintain the common travel area, which has existed since the 1920s between the United Kingdom and the Republic of Ireland. And look, there is still much to do, many miles to travel on the road to the UK exiting the European Union. I am confident that with the work that has been done to date, that Northern Ireland's voice, the particular circumstances of Northern Ireland, the history, the unique history and geography of this part of the world have been heard loudly and clearly in London. And I hope that in spite of the circumstances that we find ourselves in and at this critical time, our voice will not be heard perhaps as clearly as it should be, that those representations that have been made to date will still be heard, be listened to, and will be reflected in the upcoming negotiations.
Thank you. Time is up. That completes question time.